Ladies and gentlemen, it's go time! Hi, everyone. Welcome to The Cage on Sports Tonight Live. We've got a fantastic show for you tonight. We've got the number 48th most important person in UK MMA and the number one most important person in UK MMA.
Yeah, baby!
We've got Brad Wharton and Dave O'Donnell. Guys, how you doing?
Great.
Good to see you.
So, we've got lots and lots and lots of stuff to talk about tonight. We've had a big event this past weekend in Rio, just fantastic stuff. We had a great movie premiere we went to last night. Dave, you've been around for
ever. I'm not
should
a cave
I say
man.
How long you've been around?
I'm not a caveman. Someone said to me, they're like cave rage. That's how long I've been around. That long.
Cave rage, brilliant. So what's going on these days with cave rage?
Well, you know, it's UCMMA.com at the moment. That's how we're pushing all the shows forward this year. We've got 11 shows lined up this year. And all we want to do is just keep on a level. We've got big DVDs being released. We're pushing fighters to a new level, and Sky Sports is the limit this year, so I'm really hoping we have a great year. 2011 was great, but 2012 is going to be better.
Yeah, fantastic. And I'm kicking off my season with your show in February.
Absolutely. And I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, you and me both. So tell me a little bit about the card. Who's coming up? What's going on?
Well, you know, you've got Luke Saenz versus Peter Irvin. Great matchup. You know, they're both doing K1 in little gloves. Again, I've been slated over the internet. Oh, you can't have them guys standing in little gloves. You've seen the fights there. You've been cage side. It's nothing different. It's like an MMA fight, stand-up guys. Someone's getting knocked out, and that's the beauty of it.
Predictions?
I'd have to go with Saenz. You know,
yeah,
I'd have to go
too.
With Saenz.
Luke is a powerhouse, isn't he?
He's a powerhouse. He was going to fight Daly. The Daly upset, it didn't happen. But, you know, for him to say, I'll fight Daly, he's got to have hangers on him, hasn't he?
Yeah.
He's got to have the big ones.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, Pete's a grappler. Yeah, mostly. He's an MMA guy, mostly known for his grappling. How did you get him to take that fight with Luke?
Well, believe it or not, I'd phoned him up saying, Pete, do you want to fight Jermaine Facy? And he said, I'd love to, but now I'm into my stand-up, my Muay Thai, my K1, and I can't wait to put them little gloves on and have a go of K1. I went, you're just the man I'm looking for, mate. So it weren't really right to persuade him. He really did jump it.
Yeah, outstanding. So, yeah, that's going to be a really good fight.
And if you look at him against John McGuire, he kept the fight standing the whole time.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, that's
beat John to the punch even in that fight.
Yeah, a lot of times. So much he's very technical, and he's been to Tyler, he's been everywhere. And he's training with Kieran Kettle at the moment, second to none with striking.
Yeah, that's only gonna make him that much better. He's gonna be a dangerous man.
It's one of them. It's really hard to pull, you know. Yeah, and Corey Tate, again, you brought Corey to me, and that fight, I'll be like, Brad, help me out. This is, you know, that's going to be an amazing fight.
I'll be right there with you. I mean, you know, people are saying Corey Tate is the new Anderson Silva, this, that, and the other. And, you know, if you want to go and sit cage side for UFC and pay thousands of pounds or whatever to go and see Anderson Silva, if you're a fan of UK MMA, you can see this next generation guy, you know, in London right now. And I think it's a great opportunity for people to come down and see.
Well, I personally think if he beats Hewitt, that guy is UFC destined. You know, all our champions are going to the UFC. It's just a plain road, and Corey is ideal. You know, you look at Jose, you look at all these guys that are in the UFC, he's got the same style, he's crazy, and that's what these guys are superstars.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, yeah, and you mentioned it's a whole different breed of fighter, isn't it? I mean, you know, back in the day, UFC started, we all looked around and we all watched these, you know, these skinny little Brazilian guys come up with their magic jiu-jitsu and people sort of figured it out, right? And then there was sort of, you know, kind of the era of the wrestler and wrestlers dominated and wrestlers killed. And, you know, how many wrestlers have we seen knocked out in the last couple of weeks, right?
Well, let's talk about the best knockout. I don't want to go to UFC. I know you talk about UFC later on, but still, I'm still amazed by the Terry Etten knockout. I mean... Yeah. Yeah. I've never seen nothing like it. I said earlier on, I was training my boy hook kicks the other day, and then you've got to see this boy. And to show him that hook kick to work in an octagon, to me, probably the best knockout ever.
What I really like about guys like Corey Tate is that, you know, you say back in the day, we saw these little Brazilian guys come in and it was all style versus style. And then we've had the new generation of mixed martial artists where everybody knows everything. What we're seeing now is the guys who've got traditional background bringing that traditional Taekwondo, Kung Fu,
or boxing,
even traditional boxing.
Brad Pickett, you know, he's a boxer, and they've got 10 years already stacked up.
And they're bringing that in now, and these are the successful guys. Lyoto Machida is another one, bringing traditional martial arts in and being successful in mixed martial arts.
Yeah, well, yeah, and it's figuring out how to put those tools to good use, right? Because it's not point sparring anymore, is it?
No, I mean, you've got to go right. It's funny, Linton Vassell, you know, that's a great, that's going to be a great
fight. I can't
fight.
Wait for that one either.
Mishek's a wrestler, a grand expert, but Linton's a great striker. We haven't really seen him strike. He always takes people down. Yeah. Really, this fight, he should be standing up, anti-jiu-jitsu, and just go for the knockout.
I'll tell you what, the first time I was ever knocked out was at the hands of Mishek.
Really?
Second or third day ever training MMA in this country, and I was in with Denniston Sutherland, Dave Lee, Mishek, and me.
A good old wrestler from the USA.
Just got laid out, yeah. But yeah, and then I, getting ready for my fight with Andy, I trained with Linton, and you know, because I was looking, I was obviously training for Sledge, so I was looking for big, strong guys, tall, lanky, and yeah, I can't wait for that fight.
They've
That's
got different,
really good.
As you say, they're on a different, and it really is a different, because everyone's saying, oh, is he number two, is he number three, and you think, I can't wait, because every time they've been matched up, one of them's got injured. You know, we're 2.5 weeks away now, they're both going, I want more tickets, I'm ready, I'm going to knock him out, Dave, I'm going to do this, I'm thinking, oh my God, it's getting nearer and nearer, right? And it's still on.
We've got Ian Martell on this card as well. You've got to think that Martell's going to be up there looking to fight the
looking
winner.
Looking already. Yeah, he's looking already going, look, let me get past this guy. He's already talking about Ben Smith. You've got Ben Smith and the light heavyweight division now has jumped
stacked,
up another notch.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's good times ahead. Good
time always through your cards. I mean, we see these guys come. Another guy I want to talk about that's coming up, and there's been a big fight announcement this week with Mike Bisping.
I remember getting a phone call years and years ago. Oh, I've got this guy called DeCant. I said, what does he do? He said, he comes out in a cape. I went, does he? Oh, I like things like that. I'll have him. Yeah, and I remember, and he fought Mark Epstein, you know, and it was just, and then he fought him again. And it was just, the crowd was at Wembley was going crazy. Yeah. And he was a superstar in the making, just from the off, the way he'd walk out, you know, and they just suck up the energy. They suck up the, I am here. And he'd done that all the time. And hats off to Mark. People going, oh, he's getting paid so much. No, he's not. You know, he needs to be paid more, be a champion, because if he gets through this next fight, it's got to be Anderson.
I agree.
The UFC have come out and said that it's going to be for the number one contendership. Obviously, Mark Munoz was going to fight Sonnen. He's now injured. Bisping's taken his place. I don't think there's another person that you could put in there for the title now.
We need a British guy holding that belt. Yeah. Am I right? Yeah. Phone in, email in, phone Brett, and
absolutely.
Phone his back. Come on.
Yeah.
We need
I mean, the guy standing in his way, Chael Sonnen.
Chael's amazing. You know, the guy's a character, obviously, outside the cage. And, you know, this is an entertainment-based sport. You need guys like Chael Sonnen who can sell tickets, and he does that perfectly. The trash talk and the build-up to this is going to be off the charts. It's going to be amazing.
Because Bisping's the same, isn't it? He loves to chat.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But the thing with Sonnen is he's a guy who always backs it up, you know? He can talk outside the cage. He'll back it up inside the cage. And as a wrestler, he's on a different level to anyone in that division, and that's going to be a big problem for Mike.
Yeah, well, I mean, Mike's got a good camp around him. He's got some good people. He trains with some big, strong boys. He trains with some good. His wrestling's come on. His takedown defense is fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah. So it's interesting. You know, Bisping said that Sonnen's not going to be able to knock him out. He's not going to be able to submit him. I don't think Sonnen needs to do either of those things. I think the danger here is that Mike gets taken down repeatedly and pounded on from the top position. But a lot of people don't know about Mike Bisping. His ground game's actually not that bad. He does have some submission skill. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Bisping choke Chael Sonnen out, as crazy as that sounds.
I'd love it to happen, because the British public have got to get behind Mike. You know, they've got to start, let's get a British guy holding the belt and then to start to take UK MMA seriously. Because we've got a lot of shows out here, and let's start getting a champion in the UFC.
Chael Sonnen's got, I think, 10 or 11 submission losses, so I'm just putting it out there.
Yeah, it's good.
Mate, yeah, that's a good point.
As much as that Paisley shirt is dazzling me, I believe you. I'm near brands, trust me.
I think that's going to be absolutely fantastic. So let's talk a bit about this weekend. I mean, there's a great event in Rio this week, in the UFC event. A lot of Brazilians came, the knockout you already mentioned.
Oh.
I mean, that was certainly a highlight. I think, though, that the thing about this weekend that is totally and completely been lost because of the knockouts, because of everything, is how about that leg lock, that Paul Harris heel hook? Oh, my gosh, that was phenomenal, and on any other card, that would be all anybody's talking about.
The transition, as he took him down, as he rolled out, and it was, you could see it was planned. There weren't no, I'm scrambling for something.
No.
As he went down, he was looking for the leg straight away. Yeah. I was looking up there thinking, they might show it. And all I could see is Aldo.
Yeah. I mean, they're calling this guy the king of the leg locks. So it's for good reason. And I think you're even getting an element now of people actually being scared. Once he starts going for that lock, once he starts transitioning to it, it's almost like they're tapping out mentally because they know that
he's
injured 2-3 guys really badly with those locks. So he's got that mental thing as well.
Again, if you look at the size of him, the size of his traps, he's a bodybuilder in a fighter's body. And as you say, when he grabs hold of an ankle, there's no second chance, is it?
Tokino, his nickname means tree stump. That's what it translates
stumpy
to.
Tree, so.
You know, when I was in America and I used to coach kids wrestling at the high school, the junior high school, and I used to tell all my guys, you know, the first thing you want to do, you want to go good, solid shot, and you want to give all of your opponents that sort of Wile E. Coyote moment where they look at the camera and go, uh-oh. And as soon as he gets a hold of your leg, it's all about, uh-oh. Yeah.
And conventional wisdom in MMA is that you never pull guard, you never jump guard. And this guy, there he is, going straight down, pulling a guy on top of him. Yeah. Most people think that's suicide. You're going to get punched, you're going to get elbowed, but he's so comfortable on the ground.
He was spinning as he went down. You could see him. He was like a break dancer, spinning around for the ankle straight away. Yeah. I mean, it was poetry, as you say, poetry. But he got washed over because all the other great knockouts on the card.
Well, exactly. And then, I mean, the other one, we've got to talk about the main event, Aldo Mendes. 4:59 was that knockout. 4:59. And I, going into it, I'm the first one to admit, because I'm a wrestler and I'm always going to root for the wrestler, and I thought Mendes had that one locked. But can you imagine? Knocked out 4:59.
Well, it's funny. It's one of them things. You look at it and go, oh, can it last another second? But, I mean, he was taking big shots down. Yeah. And we had it once at Cage Rage where, and I remember looking at Grant going, what are you doing? He stopped it at 4:59. It was Anderson Silva knocking out. Oh. Anyway, it was at 4:59. I went, but when you see the replay back, he was out. One more punch, that could have been the end of the guy's career. So,
you're right.
I think the refs make the right call. You know, they're in there to do a job. Yeah. They make the right call.
We're going to talk about the refs in the second half because there's a bit of ref controversy as well.
So. Oh, it's always controversy in this show. Sports Tonight Live. Yeah. Sports Tonight Controversy, it should be called.
that Rio show had it all, didn't it? I mean, it had good knockouts, had good submissions, bit of controversy. The crowd. How about the crowd? The crowd was crazy. It was like one of your shows, Dave, but times 100. It was
brilliant. Well, we've been to Brazil before, me and Andy Gear, and when you go to a show over there, the passion, you hear all the football chanting, they get behind like you've never heard a crowd before. Yeah. You know, we was there going, and it was only like 5,000 people when we went. It was a small show, but, you know, I don't know how many thousand there, 20,000 there? I think the gate was about 20.
About 18, I think.
18, 20. Yeah. But, yeah, the crowd get behind every fight. And when the other Brazilian lost, did you hear all the boos and the... Mate, they're behind every fight.
How about when Aldo ran out in the crowd?
That was amazing. Amazing. a classic moment in mixed martial arts history. The way he went out and he was just mobbed and then raised on everyone's shoulders. It's like a Rocky movie.
I bet Dana was there going, right, I'm telling you now, you ain't getting bonus, you ain't getting this, get back in that cage now. But it was great TV.
Absolutely. Well, and you know, I think that the sports come on that much. And I mean, obviously Brazil is kind of where our roots are and where all this, you know, UFC stuff started. But I think it's really starting to come over to the US, coming over to the UK. Because, I mean, you know, I go to shows and I announce shows and I hear crowds and your events.
Crazy, yeah.
Absolutely love it. People starting to say it's go time with me. And, you know, when Buffer got up and said it's time, you could just hear the crowd.
Yeah.
And I told my wife, I said, can you hear that? She says, yeah, it's Buffer. I said, no, can you hear the crowd? That's just amazing.
The amazing thing for me was that crowd was making noise from the first fight of the evening. Now, normally you go to a UFC, you know,
I'm empty,
from the beginning, it's empty. A couple of fans, maybe a couple hundred fans for the first fight or so. That one, huge. Yeah. Almost a full house at the beginning.
Yeah. It was fantastic. Buzzing. Everybody in Brazil, you know, because we've got friends over there, Gene Silva, everyone was buzzing. They was all from all parts going to Rio.
Yeah, fantastic. So join us again. We'll be right back. Talk about more MMA. Talk about more Dave Cave Rage, UC
Cave
MMA,
Rage.
MMA Bay, all the sports, all the MMA right here on Sports Tonight Live. Welcome back to Sports Tonight Live. Last night, Brad, we had a great opportunity, didn't we? We got to go to a premiere screening of the new film Haywire with Gina Carano. Fantastic, great crowd, great people. What did you think of that film?
It was good. It was a nice, enjoyable action film. You know, some great fight scenes, some nice funny bits, and a few cheeky nods to MMA for all the MMA fans that will be watching it.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. And I think, you know, that once again, one of these films come around that's done MMA a good service because I mean, obviously we're going to gain some more fans because they're going to wonder, how did that pretty girl learn how to do it all that stuff?
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
You know,
fantastic.
A lot of MMA movies have been a bit bargain basement, but you know, this one, it's not an MMA movie, it's an MMA star in a real movie, and it can only be good for the sport, really.
Yeah, and the cast was amazing, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
everybody,
you know, Michael Douglas, Michael Fassbender, great cast.
Yeah, fantastic. I think we've got a clip.
Thank you.
In Gina.
It just starts to get better from there. I think the best scene of the whole movie comes up in a couple minutes.
Absolutely. Go and watch it. That hotel room scene, fantastic.
Yeah.
Is that the triangle? Did you whack on a triangle?
Yeah, absolutely brilliant. And Gina is fantastic. She's, you know, a lot of times, you know, and you know this, Dave, because you've put a lot of guys from your shows in contact with movie guys, and because you can fight doesn't mean you can act,
no.
Vice versa. But Gina gets in, and it was a great performance for her.
Do you know what? I was amazed at how good she was. I've seen, it's like, wow. And as you say, MMA has done us a world of good there, definitely.
Yeah.
Like Randy Couture, now you look how many films Randy's in.
Yeah, absolutely.
Come on, baby.
Yeah.
MMA
yeah.
all the way.
Absolutely. And with us on our Skype wall, another gentleman who joined us last night, one of the premier commentators, I think, in the country from Cage Warriors, John Gooden. John, are you there? So, John, what did you think of the premiere last night?
Yeah, pretty good. It was entertaining. I think that the MMA community will probably appreciate the film a little bit than average Joe. But, yeah, on the whole, it was entertaining. You can just sit back and take it in. I thought the plot was a bit odd. I think they were making it up to be something a bit more than it was. But all the same, I think I just overheard you guys saying Gina's performance was fantastic. You know, as a debut, that was spot on. And she's got some mad skills.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So we've been talking a bit about UFC this past weekend, and you and I had a bit of a chat last night at the premiere. We talked a bit about Joe Rogan and Mario Yamasaki and you know, you being a commentator who often sits in Joe's shoes. Not to stir up a bit of controversy, but you know, what did you think of that whole controversy, how it was handled, what went on?
Yeah, I don't think he handled that particularly well. He has since apologized, so I should start with that. But at the time, yeah, it's not good. I mean, I don't think that we need that in our sport. I think mixed martial arts is quite different to other sports. We don't need to have people digging out the refs. We've had it a little bit in the UK recently as well. It leaves a bad taste. I mean, these guys are trying to do a good thing, and it's so quick, so fast. We had a conversation between ourselves. Denison Sutherland was involved in that. I put it to him that in those sorts of conditions, can you control yourself? We were talking about the position of the hand on the back of the head, that kind of thing. And he was saying you can. So maybe there is a point to this. But, you know, I don't think it's down to Joe Rogan to start standing up and saying those things. He's a commentator. That isn't within the job description that I've read.
Yeah. Well, I think it's a difficult thing, and I'm going to ask your guys' opinion as well. I think, you know, I've done a lot of jobs in MMA. I've been a commentator. I've been a judge. I've been a fighter. I've been an MC. The one thing I would never, ever want to do is be a ref, because there's so much pressure. And you've got to make decisions, and I think it's easy to watch, you know, multiple angles on monitors and say, this is what I would have done, this is what I would have done. You know, it's a tough spot for anyone. And Rogan is, I mean, he's just a passionate guy, and you know, he wants to get out there and wants to make sure people understand the sport, and you know, whether he should have done that at that venue or that moment in time or not. I mean, what do you guys think?
Shoulda, coulda, woulda.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's one of them. Yeah, it's easy to say, I would have done this, I should have done that. But no, I have a right go at any of my team. The referee, and I, on the way, I was with Grant this morning, I said, Grant, every time you look at me and go, no, I know you're in charge. Because sometimes I stand up and go, and he go, no. And that's how it should be. The referee's in charge. And if he does make a mistake, he makes a mistake, end of. But I should be there going, give me that. No, you've got to step back as a promoter, as a judge, especially as a commentator or presenter. Because a lot of presenters, I've had a go at Jason before, and he go, yeah, I think this. Listen, the sport, as you say, still needs growing. Keep your mouth shut. Let them do their job. Just as a judge, as a judge's got to do their job. Oh, the judges are rubbish. Well, why don't you be a judge? Yeah, it's easy to say what you would have done. So, no, I'm 100% behind you guys. You know,
yeah,
I think the most important thing to remember is that the referees have got the most difficult job in the sport. It's completely unforgiving, because you never hear referees getting praised when they make a good call, but they get all the aggro when they've made a bad call. At the end of the day, personally, I would rather see 100 early stoppages than one that's just too late. and then we see someone go
that's
home.
A good point.
And I think with the Joe Rogan thing, I'm a big fan of referees being held accountable for what they have to do, because there isn't accountability at the moment for officials in this sport. Big fan of that. Where Rogan did it, unprofessional, it wasn't the right place or the right time. You know, if a referee wants to explain himself, he should be able to do that on his own terms. He shouldn't be railroaded in the middle of the octagon after a fight.
Yeah.
I think like, all my career, twice in my career that I've stood up and went, gone to do that and then realised. Once was, well, I said to you about Curtis Stout. It was Curtis Stout because he reminded me. Was 4:59, Anderson Silva knocks out Curtis Stout. I want to see the fight go on right. And when I've seen the replay back, I thought, he made the right choice. Keep your mouth shut, Dave. Another few years later, Leon Roberts was in and we saw the guy pull up his arm in the, what's his name? Anyway, it doesn't matter. Pull up his arm and I'm going, what do you stop it for? And only on the replay did we see his arm snap and pop round. The referee is the closest person to that fight. So I've learnt my lesson. Shut up, sit back down, keep your mouth shut. Simple, you know.
Yeah.
So, no, I'm behind the referees all the way.
Yeah, no, I agree. So John, just a couple of things. I mean, for the audience at home, what do you have coming up next? What's going on in the world of John Gooden?
I've got a pretty busy February with Cage Warriors. So getting prepared for the Lebanon, and then we're back in London, and then the Ukraine. So I don't think we're looking past there at the moment, because that's such a stacked month. That's an awful lot for the team, and especially people like Graham Boylan, Ian Dean, Patrick Vickers. That's a whole host of stuff. Dave O'Donnell will definitely appreciate that. Three shows in 1 month. So, you know, our task is pretty straightforward. It's a hell of a lot of research and scripts and stuff like that to get prepared, especially when fight cards notoriously change. but yeah, there's some really good matchups. So the Cage Warriors stuff is really exciting. I like that. I like the amateur stuff as well. I'm getting a bit of both with the stuff out in the Middle East. Some of the local guys, I think there's about 7 or 8 local fights. So they're mad. The stuff over that I've experienced in Jordan, I mean, those guys are just, they're wild. So that's pretty edgy stuff. But then you've got the consummate professionals, you've got the high level guys. So again, it's an honor to be calling fights for some of the guys that have fought internationally for some of the biggest promotions. And yeah, I'm really grateful that I get that opportunity with Cage Warriors.
Great. You're doing these shows like all over the world and seeing these local guys, as you say, where do you think personally that the next big hotbed of MMA is going to be?
I think, well, we can see that the UFC have moved over to Scandinavia. And if you look, I mean, we've got a couple of Scandinavians fighting in Beirut, and I'm not even going to try and pronounce their names, but they've got some really, really good fighters coming through. And that's only going to grow. If you ever have a look on Sherdog and just look at if you click into the fight teams and see the stack of guys that are being represented out of that stable, it's phenomenal. So, yeah, I mean, the Middle East are a little way off. They've got a very good wrestling background. We know that they're good sambo across all parts, but I'm not so sure that they don't really have a grasp of the unified rules as yet, let alone kind of kicking on from there. But it's a worldwide sport. It'd be very interesting. I'm desperate to get down to Australia to see what's happening down there, because I've heard some really good things about that part of the world as well.
Yeah, fantastic. Well, John, thanks so much for your time. We'll try to get you in the studio sometime in the near future and have you live here. If I can steal a show from Mr. Magic himself, jog on.
He nicked my line. I can't believe it.
Yeah.
It's that jacket.
Had to
it's
be
all
done.
Twinkly. It's all twinkly,
exactly
the jacket.
Right. Yeah. So we've got you know, one of the things we like to do a bit of fun. Let's talk about a dream matchup. Ken Shamrock versus Frank Shamrock. We put them on the next UC MMA show. What would happen?
You know there was talk about it years ago. Both of you must know there was talk. And they hated each other for such a long time. And yeah, my money would be on Frank all day long.
You think?
Yeah, he's younger. He was a different fighter to Ken altogether, you know. But Ken, I was a big fan of Ken, because back in the day, he was a years ahead of his time. But people catch up, we're like dinosaurs. I'm an old man now, and people, they caught up with you, and they trample you to your flat. And I'm flat at the moment. But, you know, back in the day, people can't touch you. And Ken was one of them men, but Frank all day long.
He was one of those guys in America when they would advertise, you know, the big deep voice. On the Ultimate Fighting Championship, Ken Shamrock versus
Oleg Tartikoff.
Yeah. It's fantastic. Yeah,
and, you know, speaking about that, Oleg, look how many films he's been in, the MMA movies, you know. MMA's taking over the world.
Absolutely,
I got into sport in the mid to late 90s, and that Ken was the world's most dangerous man. But as a fighter, I think he was a guy who was an athlete before there were athletes in the sport. He had all the physical side of it, and he had the ground game, which others didn't have. I don't ever think he was the greatest mixed martial artist in the world. I think he was the man, he was there at the right time in the right place. In terms of a fight between him and Frank, Frank was an athlete and a mixed martial artist. And I think at the end of the day, we know from history that always wins out.
Yeah.
I've trained with Frank.
Put it on,
and,
Dave.
And he's a... I'd love to, mate. If I could have thought, I'd say, I've had Ken. Frank Shamrock, believe it or not, was at Cage Rage number one. We got him drunk at the after party. He was proper out of it. We'd done a seminar with him beforehand, like, what I put in my body stays in my body. It's one of the most perfect. And we're all like, wow. At the after party, he's like, give me another beer. I'll have another. We're all like, it just shows you, you know. But he was a perfect athlete, really was a perfect athlete.
I think we're about out of time, guys. Thank you so much for your time tonight.
Pleasure.
This has been really, really fun. So for Brad Wharton, Dave O'Donnell, number 48 and number one.
Number one,
I'm Hollywood.
Baby.
Thanks for joining us on The Cage, Sports Tonight Live. See you next time.